Hey everybody, Brion McClanahan here. The woke madness in history education is off the rails. Well, how do we change it? McClanahanacademy.com. And because you listen to this podcast, if you use the coupon code PODCAST at checkout, you get 25% off every day, all day, 365 days a year on every class at McClanahanacademy.com. So go to McClanahanacademy.com, use coupon code PODCAST at checkout, and get a real history education at 25% off. If you like this podcast and you want it without advertisements, head over to patreon.com and become a member of the Brion McClanahan Show. For 10 bucks a month, you get all the podcasts ad-free, including video, and you also get a special Q&A podcast. I'm only going to answer your questions, your listener-generated episodes, through those Q&A. So head over to patreon.com, get this podcast ad-free, no ads, not even things like this, and you really do help support the Brion McClanahan Show with really cool stuff on the back end. Get the book that Kevin Gutzman called the single best volume on original intent ever written, My Founding Fathers' Guide to the Constitution. It is the book. When people ask me what's my favorite, that's the one. Pick it up wherever books are sold online and get a real education on the Constitution. There's an old saying, when you've got the right enemies, you're doing something right. And I'm going to talk about that with Donald Trump and the New York Times again. This is a New York Times week. It's a lot of fun on this episode of the Brion McClanahan Show.
It's time to think locally and act locally. Welcome to the Brion McClanahan Show.
Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. Glad to be back on the program. Very glad to be here. All right. Donald Trump has made all the right enemies. Now, look, Donald Trump has got a lot of problems. His administration was a mess. And maybe that was on purpose. I mean, there's been some speculation about that. He's done a lot of unconstitutional things, or did a lot of unconstitutional things as president. He's a megalomaniac. He's got some real issues. But when you make the right enemies and the right people hate you, it's almost worth voting those people into office. I've said this before, Donald Trump couldn't have done any more to undermine the authority of the presidency than anyone else. And see, what's actually happened in America right now is really interesting. If you want to make if you want to reduce the power of the presidency or reduce what we think about the American monarchy, you need a wrecking ball in the White House. You need someone that is going to disrupt the whole system. Joe Biden's not that. You think about the people that wanted Joe Biden in there. They wanted to restore the dignity of the presidency, to bring back the American king. This is what they're really trying to do. Donald Trump was uncontrollable. Donald Trump was really no worse than Franklin Roosevelt, according to the left. I mean, he did most of the things Roosevelt would have done. He wasn't someone that was very committed to the Constitution or the original constitutional order or the original founder's executive in any way. But the left hates him because they can't control him. And you see, that's the issue. All these other Republican presidents, whether it was George H.W. Bush, George W. Bush, I mean, those people can be controlled. Even Ronald Reagan with the neoconservatives in his administration, the West Coast Straussians that were there too. I mean, he can be controlled. Gerald Ford, Richard Nixon tried to appeal to the left the entire time he was in office. I mean, it was embarrassing. He could be controlled. And so what's happened is really interesting. The old line Republicans don't like the fact that Donald Trump is not sufficiently in line with the establishment order, even though he's one of them. Even though Donald Trump is more establishment than just about anybody else could be establishment, he's one of them. But yet, because he doesn't always toe the line, he's dangerous. Now, there are a lot of Republicans, the Never Trumpers, who spill a lot of ink and blow a lot of hot air about how Donald Trump is going to destroy America. This is just complete stupidity. But it's what they do, and the New York Times ran a piece a couple of weeks ago by Peter Wenner, who had served in the Bush administrations and is upset that Republicans want Donald Trump in there. And there's some, he wrote a piece for the New York Times, an opinion piece, talking about how this is, again, for the soul of the Republican Party, for the soul of the country, we got to go out and get rid of Donald Trump. We have to stop him somehow. Some way, somehow, Trump has to be stopped. Because you know what's going to happen? We're going to get a monarchy, a dictatorship. Now, the lack of historical awareness is tremendous on these people. They can't see that we've already got that. Trump is just a symptom of the disease. If the disease wasn't always there, Trump would mean nothing. A Donald Trump administration would be meaningless. It would be harmless if we actually had a constitution that functioned, a federal republic that functioned, a 10th Amendment that functioned, a Congress that functioned. If we had these things, if we had states that actually realized they have powers, Donald Trump would be irrelevant. Joe Biden would be irrelevant. Barack Obama would have been irrelevant. So would George W. Bush, Bill Clinton, George H.W. Bush, Ronald Reagan. All these people would have been irrelevant. There is one thing I agree with. Donald Trump and the way that he's able to get away potentially with murder, as this guy says. Well, we know that's true for Republicans. He says Republicans would rally around this guy. We know that's true. We know why. Because of Abraham Lincoln. He got away with murder. He killed 1 million Americans. And they love the guy. Think about that. Think about honoring a president that's responsible for the death of 1 million Americans. There's no one else that has that on their resume. But yet Abraham Lincoln is somehow the symbol of America. The person that people look to as the symbol of America killed more Americans than anyone else in American history. I mean, think about that for a second. You have George Washington didn't kill any Americans. In fact, when he had the opportunity as president to march into Pennsylvania, round up traitors and rebels, he pardoned them all. He didn't care if people burned him in effigy. Who cares? Resigned his commissions, resigned as president, resigned from all his offices. That is a real American. And I have my problems with George Washington and marching into Western Pennsylvania and the Neutrality Proclamation and other things. I mean, I think he set a pretty bad standard, signing the bill that incorporated the First Bank of the United States. There's problems with Washington. But, I mean, my gosh, that should be the symbol of America. Or Thomas Jefferson, who on his first inaugural says, you know what, we've got dissent, we've got differences. Let the people that don't agree with me say whatever they want. And let them remain undisturbed. Let's do that. Nope. That's not what we have in the executive branch now. It's, let's arrest all of my political opponents. Let's use the federal government to abuse these people. Let's do all the things we can to ensure that my political opponents, whether they're just the simple voters, we're going to demonize them, or whether it's my opponent who we're trying to bankrupt, can no longer have any power in this government. That's like John Adams, who signed the Sedition Act. You see, John Adams is not really that conservative. This is what we have to be careful of. Or like Franklin Roosevelt, who actually used the power of the general government against Charles Lindbergh, even though he knew full well what Lindbergh was doing the entire time and endorsed it. Yet, Lindbergh became a problem after he gave a speech in opposition to Franklin Roosevelt in 1941. September 11th, 1941, in fact. One of the other September 11th dates. Well, then Lindbergh has to be abused by the general government. Again, think about that. So what we have is Donald Trump representing a problem for the establishment. He is an issue because they can't corral him. They can't control him, and they don't know what to do about it except try to eliminate him, not physically, but any of his supporters and their power, right? They want to reduce his power. If they bankrupt him, that's what they'll do. There's a piece by Jamel Bowie at the New York Times today, as I'm recording this, talking about Trump's above the law. He had this big settlement, big bond, then they reduced it down. Yes, because it's probably a violation of the New York Constitution. If you go out and look at it, there's actually in the Bill of Rights of the New York Constitution, again, an amendment against excessive fines. And $400 million was an excessive fine. Anybody could see that. It was designed to bankrupt him. It was an excessive fine. Particularly when CNN goes on the air and says, you know, we should just sell Mar-a-Lago. I mean, it's worth hundreds of millions, whereas the judge in New York said it's only worth $18 million. I mean, it's so ridiculous. These people don't even realize how silly they sound. Again, the goal, just like it was in 1798, is to make it to where we do not have a political opposition in the election cycle, to silence the opposition. That's the goal. Because they know that the opposition, should they get in power, they can control the levers of power just like the left can. And this is what they worry about. I talked about it this week. They worry about conservatives using those same levers of power against them. The things they created, the imperial presidency they created, the left in America created. No conservative can get a hold of it because that would be dangerous for them because they know what it can do. They know they can go after their political opponents. They know they can abuse power. This is their birthright. You see? How dare these people, the unwashed, the unclean, the irredeemable deplorables, how dare these people think they can have any authority in Washington, D.C.? And when you have people like Peter Wenner, who write opinion pieces for the New York Times, blasting Republicans, what do you expect? He's supposed to be one of them. No, not these Republicans, not the MAGA Republicans. He's not one of them. Those are extremists. You have had Joe Biden stand up and say this. Think about the actual abuse that's being perpetrated by the general government against its political opponents. Biden's State of the Union address wasn't a State of the Union address. It was a campaign speech. It was there to demonize his opponents. That was the whole point. It wasn't about the nature of the current State of the Union and the economy. It really wasn't about that. It's about vote for me so I can abuse my political opponents a little more. And, I mean, this is what American politics have gotten to. It's really quite sad. But I want to read this piece by Peter Wenner. It's not long. Again, at the New York Times. He says, for the thousandth time, the Republican Party refused an off-ramp that would free itself from Donald Trump. As long as he's around, it never will. Oh, yeah. We had an off-ramp. Peter Wenner. And you know who his heroes are? We'll get to that. And when you hear who his intellectual heroes are, you'll understand why Peter Renner wrote this piece. If these people hate you, you're doing something right. In this year's presidential primary campaign, the party had the chance to nominate Nimrata Haley. Actually, he says Nikki Haley. But I mean, look, Nikki Haley was a bad candidate, is a bad candidate. But to Peter Renner, she's a successful, conservative, questionable, former two-term governor of South Carolina. Unlike Mr. Trump's, her public career has been characterized by a lifetime of moral squalor. Peter Wenner must not know Nikki Haley very well, because if you go back, if you know anybody from... I mean, this is laughable when these people come, well, unlike Donald Trump, this woman has an impeccable character. You know how many times... There was huge stories on Nikki Haley and her infidelity to her husband over and over again. Oh, yes. No moral scandals. Of course, Ron DeSantis did a beautiful hit piece on Nikki Haley where it showed her saying one thing and then saying the opposite all the time. The woman is a walking case of contradictions. But no lifetime of moral squalor. No, no, no. None of that. It's just her entire character. She's awful. Awful. But to Peter Wenner, you know why Peter Wenner likes her? Well, because she's from the war party. She likes guns and butter. She is just like Franklin Roosevelt or Lyndon Johnson. I mean, that's what these people are. The winner is a neocon. And that's what she is. And she works for the defense industry, right? She's a lobbyist, makes a lot of money. She's going to make sure the guns keep flowing and the butter keeps buttering. And many polls show she would have been a more affordable candidate against President Biden than Mr. Trump. Yeah, I mean, ridiculous. No matter. Mr. Trump decimated Ms. Haley most recently on Super Tuesday. She suspended her campaign the next day, but she never had a chance. Yeah, because unlike Mr. Wiener, I mean Wenner, Peter Wenner, Republican voters generally know about Nikki Haley. They know what she is, particularly in the South. They know what Nikki Haley is. The Republican Party has grown more radical, unhinged, and cult-like every year since Mr. Trump took control of it. Yes, unhinged, cult-like, radical. Yeah. Unhinged, radical, cult-like. Now, granted, you look at some people that support Trump, it's a little strange. I mean, a lot strange, in fact. Radical? Define that. Is radical adhering to, I don't know, the principles of 98, is that radical when they were written by James Madison and Thomas Jefferson? Not very radical, I don't think. Is radical supporting the positions of the old Republicans? I mean, this is where the base of the party is. It's not where Trump is, but it's where the people of the party want to go. Is that radical? To Peter Wiener, it would be. But to the base, no. In 2016, there was outrage among Republicans after the release of the Access Hollywood tape. On the tape, in words that shocked the nation, Mr. Trump said that when you're a star, you can do anything. You can do anything. I'm not going to, because this is a G-rated podcast, I won't say what the quotations there, but maybe you can talk to your children if they're listening to this about what he actually said, and you can go out and get the article. But Trump said you can do anything. You can grab them, right? You can grab the women. And there was outrage among Republicans. I don't know how many. I mean, a lot of people were like, yeah, okay. I mean, look, people expect this. See, what Peter Wiener, I mean, Wenner, doesn't realize is that we're in the age of Rome now. We've gotten to the point of Rome. People just shrug their shoulders. What are you going to do about it? Joe Biden's corrupt. Donald Trump's corrupt. We have to pick between the two less corrupt people. Or the people that are both corrupt, not necessarily less corrupt, but the person that might advance some positions that we like, even if they're corrupt. I mean, do you think the Romans really thought anything about, well, this Roman emperor is, I mean, this guy's bad, that guy's bad? It didn't matter. What were they going to do about it? We haven't gotten to the point where we're eliminating our political opponents violently. That's a good thing. Even though that happened with the Republican Party in the 1860s, they violently eliminated their opponents. I mean, this is true, right? So the Republican Party has always been willing to violently eliminate its opponents. In 2023, Mr. Trump was found liable for sexual abuse. What some people dismissed as his locker room talk turned out to be more than just talk. Yet no Republican of significance said a critical word about it. People know what Trump is. They've always known it. I mean, you ask people like, yeah, we know what Trump is. But he's not Joe Biden. And he's willing to fight back. I think that's the thing that draws people to Donald Trump more than anything else. He fights back. He's not Peter Wiener sitting on the sideline, wanting just to grab the coattails of whoever's in office and please give me a platform like the New York Times. Donald Trump is willing to fight back. He's willing to take the hits. They look at him almost as a martyr. I mean, this guy has been raked over the coals for them, right? I mean, this is how the Trump voter generally thinks. This is for me. He says it when he's on the campaign trail. This is for me. He's doing all this for me. He's doing it for us, for America. His sacrifice is there. Now you ask, I mean, how much of a sacrifice is it? But I mean, I think in some ways it is pretty substantial. I mean, the amount of vitriol that one person takes and going to court for all of these things and the laughable show trials that he's been part of, and we know the corruption of the justice system he's in. The district attorney in Georgia is a joke. The judge in New York is a joke. The DA in New York is a joke. These people are jokes. They're clowns. And everybody can see it. And that's why they don't care. Because they know that the other side is a bunch of losers who are just jealous and want to get somebody. I mean, these people are vindictive. Look, the Democrats will go after you. They love to abuse power. Republicans won't do it as much. That's what the Democrats are afraid of, though, because Trump says he will. And that this piece actually gets into that. And Peter Wiener doesn't like it. The same was true this year when Mr. Trump was found liable for civil fraud. The judge in the case, Arthur F. Engeron, said that the former president's complete lack of contrition bordered on pathological. Yet Republicans were united in their outrage, not in response to Mr. Trump's actions, but at the judge for the size of the penalty. That's because it was a joking, it was a circus, a show trial. This is what you would find in Nazi Germany during the 1930s, show trials. That's all it was. It's a joke. You look at the value of the asset. No one would ever say Mar-a-Lago, where it's positioned, and the history of the property was only worth $18 million. But that's what they did to try to get a verdict that suited them. I mean, this is stupid. Today, many Republicans not only profess to believe that the election was stolen, prominent members of Congress like Representatives Elise Stanifec and Senator J.D. Vance say they would not have certified the 2020 election results as Vice President Mike Pence, to his credit, did. Mike Johnson, who played a leading role in trying to overturn the election, is Speaker of the House. To Peter Wenner, this is crazy. Well, maybe these people are just asking questions. We know Democrats wouldn't have done it. We know Democrats were trying to not certify the election in 2016. They called it stolen. We know that we had a candidate for governor in Georgia run around for a year, Stacey Abrams, saying that she was a legitimate governor of Georgia. This is how she had her career. And then, of course, blown apart on TV when Joe Biden called her up. Oh, she was ready. This is before, this is one of the funny, if you want to see a funny video, go out and find the video of Joe Biden before he had announced who his vice president is. And Stacey Abrams was on the tele. We were going to have a big announcement. Stacey Abrams with Joe Biden. She thought she was going to be asked to be vice president on national television. Joe Biden gets on the phone with her, gets on the video, and doesn't ask her. And it was, you can see the look. Oh, this is not what that's about. The power-hungry people in the Democratic Party. Kamala Harris is a joke, too. But, of course, I predicted in 2016, closer to 2020, excuse me, who was going to be the Democrat nomination. I said at first it was Stacey Abrams, and I said second was Kamala Harris. Go back and look at those. That's what I said. Oh. You could see it deflated. Where is she now? I have no idea. Her political career was crushed. It was ended on that day. And maybe it was done on purpose because I think the Democrats could see she was actually an embarrassment. They knew she didn't win. She was embarrassing. They had to do something about it. So they got rid of her, essentially. Threw her under the bus. Once they didn't pick her, that was it. I guess she could run for some office in Georgia, but she's done. Republicans not only excused the attack on the Capitol on January 6th, Mr. Trump and his party now glorify the insurrections. At his kickoff campaign rally for 2024, a song called Justice for All played, featuring him and the J6 prison chair made up of prisoners charged with crimes related to the riot. Republicans are not only convinced that he was unfairly impeached and unfairly indicted. Well, he was unfairly impeached. What they impeached him for was not an impeachable offense. I could find other things. Look, I could go back and impeach just about every president in the last 100 years, come up with articles of impeachment. It's not hard. These people have been abusing power for a long time. But what they impeached him for wasn't an impeachable offense because there's no evidence. That was the problem. Joe Biden has got more potential skeletons in his closet than Donald Trump ever had in terms of abusing power and other things. I mean, it's worse. They're also completely untroubled by his threats against and slander of judges, law clerks, and prosecutors, not to mention his attempts to influence and intimidate witnesses. Well, that's because Americans... I mean, the funny thing is, now I know Wiener is not a Democrat, but the Democrats do this exact same thing. This is the weird thing about these never-Trumpers. They want some level of decorum that doesn't exist. Trump plays by the rules of the left. And I get it's rough, and I get it's vulgar, and I get those things. I mean, when I watch a Trump speech, it's not very good. They're not good at all. But you know who's not? John C. Calhoun's not walking through that door. Thomas Jefferson, George Washington, they're not walking through the door. Alexander Hamilton even is not walking through the door. They are fine with the former president referring to the radical left thugs that live like vermin within the confines of our country. Well, I mean, what did Hillary Clinton call Trump supporters? Irredeemable deplorables. I mean, this is the language of the modern era. To think that somehow this is weird, it's what the left has been doing for years. Now, it goes back to the 1850s. Republicans have used language like this before. They called Southerners all kinds of things in the 1850s. I mean, this is... The funny thing is Peter Wenner wants a world that doesn't exist. And insinuating that the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Mark Wiley, deserved to be executed for committing treason. They are fine with Mr. Trump encouraging Russia to attack our NATO allies. I don't know if he's ever done that. I mean, show me an example. He drops this but has no verification for it. And comparing himself with Alexei Navalny. The Kremlin's fiercest and bravest critic who died while serving time in a remote Russian prison for his political beliefs. Is there not something to that? I mean, are they not trying to throw him in jail? So, I mean, this piece is strange. They are fine with his suggesting termination of the Constitution and with one of Mr. Trump's lawyers arguing that if, as president, Mr. Trump ordered the SEAL Team 6 to assassinate an opponent, he could be immune from criminal prosecution. This is only a tiny sample of what he's been saying and doing for years. Whereas Trump said he'd terminate the Constitution. And again, a lot of what Trump does on the campaign trail is hyperbole. Trump, the governor... When I say governor in terms of actually in office, is different from Trump the campaigner. Joe Biden's the same. He's practically falling asleep each time. Call them Fifth Avenue Republicans. Fifth Avenue Republicans support Mr. Trump regardless of what he does, even if, as he said in 2016, he stood in the middle of Fifth Avenue in New York and shot someone. This wasn't an exaggeration. It was prophecy. Oh yeah, because Trump has done that? What a weird statement. We know Republicans have. We know Democrats have. We know that Democrats have thrown a lot of Republicans in jail. The radicalization of the Republican Party isn't going to abate anytime soon. Another band of traditional Republicans who could serve as a counterweight to MAGA Republicans is fleeing Congress. Thank God. Nothing says stupid like a Republican, particularly a traditional Republican. Republicans who recently left or are about to leave include Mitt Romney, thank you, Ben Sasse, good, Liz Cheney, awesome, Adam Kinzinger, good, Kathy McMorris Rogers, have no idea who that is, Patrick McHenry, who cares, Kay Granger, worthless, Will Hurd, terrible, Ken Buck, awful, Mike Gallagher, who cares, these people are gone, so what? Some of these people have said privately that they knew that continuing to serve in Congress as representatives of a party saying good things about Mr. Trump that they knew weren't true was not good for their souls. Okay, sayonara. See you later. I mean, does it really matter? Are these people really going to tip the scales in favor of good government? 26 Republican senators voted against the recent aid package for Ukraine. Oh my gosh. When a pre-Trump Republican Party would have overwhelmingly supported it. And that's the problem. And of the 17 Republican senators who were elected beginning in 2018, who are age 55 or younger, 15 voted no. What a ringing endorsement of young Republicans in the Congress. I mean, that's beautiful. In other words, the MAGA takeover of the Republican Party is complete. Not really. It's not complete yet. Until you don't have dopes like Mitt Romney and Ben Sasse and Peter Wiener and Mitch McConnell. Until you don't have these people in power, it's not complete. Mitch McConnell, who's one of the most influential majority leaders in the history of the Senate and excoriated Mr. Trump for his role in the attack on the Capitol on January 6th from the floor of the Senate, recently announced he was stepping down from the Republican leadership, and soon after that, he announced he was endorsing Mr. Trump. It was a surrender to Mr. Trump, an acknowledgement of his dominance. Well, he's stepping down because the man has literal brain freezes. He'll stand there and he has no idea what's going on. He's probably too old to be in government. Frankly, so is Joe Biden and Donald Trump. I mean, you want to be honest, but Mr. Trump will be the Republican nominee for a third time. His imprint on the Republican Party is now comparable with, and in some ways exceeds, Ronald Reagan's. And that imprint is likely to last for at least a generation. It is a staggering achievement. It also presents a profound threat to the country. Oh, there it is. Whatever one thought of the Republican Party pre-Trump, it was not fundamentally illiberal or nihilistic. Its leaders were not sociopathic, merciless con men, wantonly cruel and lawless. Are you sure about that? Are you sure that Abraham Lincoln's not in that bunch? No area of Mr. Trump's life appears to have been untouched by moral corruption. As a young man, Peter Wiener says, I was influenced by conservatives like George Will, Irving Kristol, and James Q. Wilson. Oh, yeah. Nothing says conservative like Irving Kristol or George Will. That shows you where this numbskull is coming from. I served in three Republican administrations, including as a senior advisor in the White House under President George W. Bush, and voted Republican in 9 consecutive presidential campaigns, beginning with Mr. Reagan in 1980. My political tribe was Republican. So are most of my friends. To see what the GOP has become is mortifying. As someone who loves America, I find it terrifying. I mean, this is all just hyperbole and emotional. It's emotivism. It's stupid. It's a stupid paragraph. And of course, when you're calling out again George Will and Irving Kristol as your guys, you've got problems. To get a better sense of this moment, I reached out to the Pulitzer Prize-winning historian John Meacham. Nothing says conservative like John Meacham, right? And this is one of the quotes, the funniest thing. Historically speaking, John Meacham said, the forces now in control of the Republican Party represent the most significant threat to basic constitutionalism we've experienced since the Civil War. Donald Trump represents a bigger threat than anything since the Civil War. Yeah. Of course, Mr. Meacham has also helped devise some of Biden's speeches. That's not a partisan point. It's just the fact of the matter. And I'm not talking about particular policies about which we can and should disagree. I'm talking about the self-evident willingness of a once noble party to embrace lies and the will to power over essential democratic norms. I mean, when you've got John Meacham on your side, you know that you're doing something right. Not really. Since 2015, Peter Wiener has been repeatedly warning Republicans about Mr. Trump, describing him as a kind of demagogue the founders feared, malignant and malicious, a man with a disordered personality. At this point, 8 years ago, I said that while the struggle for the Republican nomination was over, the struggle for the soul of the party was not. Once Mr. Trump won the presidency, I knew it was. He and the Republican Party fused ideologically. It's now a populist rather than a conservative party. Its instincts are nativist, protectionist, and isolationist. But the most significant fusion is ethical and moral. The Republican Party keeps getting darker. It's become an anti-intellectual, conspiracy-minded, and authoritarian organization, intemperate and brutish, transgressive, and anarchistic. And there's no end in sight. Mr. Trump is a human blowtorch, prepared to burn down democracy. So is his party. And there's no bottom. There's no bottom. When there's no bottom, there's no bottom. What beautiful, intelligent language. When there's no bottom, you know, there's no bottom. Hey, I've got an analogy for you. When there's no bottom, you know what? There's no bottom. The next 34 weeks are the most consequential in the life of this nation. Mr. Trump was a clear danger in 2016. He's much more of a danger now. The former president is more vengeful, more bitter, and more unstable than he was, which is saying something. There would be fewer guardrails and more true believers in a second Trump turn. He has already shown that he'd overturn an election, support a violent insurrection, and even allow his vice president to be hanged. There's nothing he won't do. It's up to the rest of us to keep him from doing it, right? So, you know, Trump is so bad, he was going to let his vice president, I think he wasn't, Mike Pence wasn't going to be hanged. I mean, this is just stupid. But you are the problem. Trump is a problem, but you're a problem because you facilitate that, if you're a Trump supporter, according to Peter Weiner. You're a problem. All right. Hope you enjoyed this episode of the Brion McClanahan Show. We're wrapping up the week. See you next time on the next show. See you then.